Very dumb conversation. So, where do we start?
You said you were 5.
Do you want me to start when I was 5 years old?
Yes.
And I live when I'm 21 years old. Alright, that's right. That's right. I come from Kenya. And I come from a very special group of people. They're called the Maasai.
It's Maasai, not Maasai.
Maasai.
I hope you got to take
note. With double A. I call them special people because I think we're famous and we even know that we are famous. They tell stories that people actually travel. And you're all included to come and see the Maasai. We are people who, we are nomads. We used to be nomads until the government said no more. And we love cows. So if there are cows in Zimbabwe, please send them to Kenya because they belong to the Maasai. We believe that. We believe that when we came from heaven, we were on a hide and God dropped us on earth and we were with our cows and we were amazed how beautiful earth was. And while we were being amazed and wondering, people stole our cows. So that's why there are cows in Zimbabwe. A cow is the signature in our, the more cows you have, that's the more wealthy you are. We value a cow because from milk, everything, growing up, we sit on the skin of a cow was cooked and we sleep on the cow's skin. So we use everything from a cow. So it's a very valuable resource for us. And the stories of us drinking cow blood, yeah, that's what we used to do. A couple of times, I don't do that anymore. I grew up from that community, very rural. I didn't know that it was rural. After I went outside, now I know, those running, it's typical rural African village with no running water, no paved roads, electricity, we lived in huts. I was born first in my family.
First born.
I'm the first born. What number are you?
I'm also the first born.
Oh, yeah. We share something.
Yeah, exactly.
So we can have this conversation. And being a first born, especially for a girl, it means that you actually become a mother as soon as you start walking. Because everything my mom did, I did. So I went to the river, collected water, sweep the house, cook for my siblings, take care of them. If one is, I did everything. And so that's the life I grew up. But what is interesting about growing up, because my mom was very hardworking, I got to be booked, that's what they are told. A family booked me so that I can get married to their son at a younger age.
And did you know the son?
No, I was just 5. But my mom tells me they actually had a mark in my stomach, in my mom's stomach, that if she gave birth to a child, a girl, they would marry.
Wow.
So it is booked, I was booked very, when I was very early. So I grew up knowing who my husband was going to be, and everything I did was pretty much to prepare me to become that wife.
So you grew up and you see this young boy as well just doing some of the chores as well, and you know that this is the guy that I'm going to marry.
Yeah, well, actually, boys don't do many chores. They only take care of the cows,
yes.
Then they come and demand food. So they are told to be men, they don't go to the kitchen.
They don't go to the kitchen.
Mm-hmm. two different worlds.
Completely. And then turning to school. You had boys at your school?
Yes. Actually, you know, we are told boys are supposed to go to school.
And then go on it.
Girls, you get married. Why do you need an education? Where are you going to use it? Boys can be the chief, can be the member of parliament, can be the banker, can be the lawyer, can be out there earning income. But you, as a mother, you stay home and take care of the children. So, yes, girls went to school, but we went there just to pass time and grow up.
Before getting married.
Okay.
So, your father allowed you to go to school, and then, as you tell the story, you negotiated to continue going to school.
Actually, my mom made me go to school.
Your mom made you go to school?
Yes. Because she dropped out of school when she was in fourth grade.
Okay.
And because she got married and had us.
Yes.
And my dad worked as a policeman. He lived in the city.
Okay.
He came home once a year. We never saw him sometimes for many years.
Mm-hmm.
Two. And my mom lived a very typical life. Like so many African women. She worked hard to make sure we ate. And the life that she was living was very, very hard. And so she told us that if she stayed in school, she would not be living the life she was living. And so she wanted us, as girls and boys, my mom's home, to go to school. So I went to school because of my mom.
So she instilled education in your life?
Yes.
So dad was away most of the time,
mm-hmm.
and you were there with mom and the rest of your siblings.
Yes.
How did you, I understand at some point you then had to talk, had to convince the elders to allow, for you not to go. So you had two negotiations, I believe there's one negotiation with your dad. I did my research. You had one negotiation with your dad, another one with the elders in the village. So they allowed you to go to school up until 21. Then you left to go to the US. As a young adult coming from Kenya, coming from your small village, or your village, what was it like to go to the US? What was that transition like for you?
I think, first it was even just a transition to go to high school. Because when I was going to go to high school, then that was the time I was supposed to be married. And I talked to my dad to let me go to school. And he did let me go to high school. And then going to the US, where it was an opportunity that I saw many men go, and there was never a consideration of a woman or a girl going. So when I approached the guys, there was a lot of resistance, and people really didn't want me to leave. But I managed to talk to the villagers to enable me to go. And I think my whole life I've been searching about wanting a better life. When I started going to school, I met teachers who inspired me. You know, they called me Madam Kakenya, they were really Madam then. My teachers, the female teachers especially, the way they were dressed up, you know, we look at young kids in the village and we think only the princesses are in the minds of the girls in the city. No, even in those villages, they want to look nice as women. And so the fact that they were dressing, you know, changing clothes every other day, every day they had a different dress, and I only had one. You know, I had a uniform and I had something for home.
Yes.
So I wanted to have more, and I knew the way to do that was to become a teacher. And then So I was searching for a better life. That's what I was having. My transition of going to the U.S. was, I really worked very hard to get my community to support me to go. And, you know, that time you enter the plane, you're like, bye-bye, problems of my village, I'm going away. But when you go out and you look into your culture from outside, it was really, for me, a very big eye-opener.
Okay.
Because the practices that we did practice, we were told it's part of the culture. The issues of female genital cutting, it was processed, it was a process to make you a woman, an adult, transitioning you from childhood to adulthood. But we were not told about the, you know, it's against the law. We were not told about what actually happens to you. But because I went through it and being outside and reading that this is actually against the law and that we, you know, we should not be subjecting young girls to this torture. It's like, really, it did happen to me, and it's happening. And then, you know, learning that, you know, kids have rights. They have the right to go to school. You know, we go to school that, you know, teachers never paid attention to girls, because anyway, they're going to be married, so let's concentrate on the boys. You know, I had the right to be in that class, and the teacher had the right to pay attention to me and to teach me and educate me. And I looked at so many separations we have. You know, when we go to school, we tell the girls to sweep the classroom.
Yes.
You know, they're the ones collecting firewood. I used to be told to cook for the teachers. So even in the school, I was also being instilled that you are a wife, you are a woman, this is where you belong. So I think, you know, it was time for me to really reflect and also observe, you know, just take in as much as I could. I went to the U.S. wanting to study economics, which I tried very hard until I took a class on money. And it was called the Money and Banking. And after that class, I went to the International Relations teacher and said, I'm not going back there. I found myself drawn into politics. So I did political science. I got drawn into international relations, international development, talking about the issues that are affecting women. And, you know, when you are in another world, they're talking about Africa, and they're talking about, and I'm thinking, that's my people. And when I read stories that were people that I knew. So that really hit me, and that transition kind of just changed my whole life, and that's what I do now, is try to do what I can in the society to empower girls and women.
Just touching on the cutting that you're talking about, is that still practiced in 2014?
Yes.
And so nothing's changed, I guess, or is it?
You know, it's
Where the culture, sometimes culture is a way of enforcing, or you must do this because you're a man, you must do this because you're a girl.
I think there are some that are, well, being a genital cutting is still going on.
So good.
It's not practiced publicly the way they used to. Now it's more underground because there are more activists and more advocates like me who talk about it and who really teach people, but also bring justice where certain cases happen. We have issues that, you know, they're done in the middle of the night when people are sleeping. We've had issues of, you know, girls even dying during the practice. So it still goes on, but not as publicly as it used to be. At least people are aware that the law is there. Mm-hmm. Even if we're practicing, we can't just be out there.
Okay. So going back to the steps, So you went over there, you were 21, you had a lot of time to reflect, then you decided to pursue political science, right? And international relations. And then you ended up in education. So this was you following, I guess, your passion. So the idea to start the school, I'm leaving a lot of gaps because I want you guys to then join the conversation and ask. But so the idea to just the school that you run, when was that idea born?
I think through when I was in the US, but also when I was a young girl going to school. I used to have, my home used to be at this fast, so I wouldn't go home for lunch. And sometimes I would be sitting under a tree, you know, and go into this sleep cell. For some reason, I used to go into another world. That I saw young girls being happy, excited, and so I think that stuck in me. And when I went to the US, I got an opportunity to visit so many schools for girls. There are a lot of girls' schools, some boarding, some day schools, and I saw what I wanted it to be in my village. And so I came back having that desire of, you know, when you want to change something, you have to point at a place or at something. And to me, education has made a difference in my life. So that's what I wanted to enable others to have.
And so how long has this school been running for?
The school is 6 years old.
6 years old.
Yeah.
Okay. There's a quote, it says, this is you speaking, right? So I watched a video where someone interviewed you, and so obviously you built the first primary school in your village. And so the school, and these are your words, is a place where girls can be free. Do you remember these words? A place where a girl can be free, a place where they can dream, a place that lets them know that their dreams are possible.
Yes.
You remember those words?
I believe that.
Okay, good. Remember those words? She also said those words here in Zimbabwe.
Yes.
So 6 years, 6 years of operation. How many girls do you have in the school?
We have 170 girls.
Okay.
It's a boarding school.
It's a boarding school?
Yes. A boarding school because one is I wanted them to be safe. Most of the girls, there are so many issues of rape, defilement, when they are walking to school and coming home. So it is, they are coming to school very early in the morning, they are going home very late. So the more you let them out, the higher chances that something will happen to them. And also taking out when you send them home, the parents still, the moment the girl walks into that store, they are like, oh, here is a jerrycan, go get some water. You know, they're not really led to be given an opportunity to learn.
Do you give it
home? Yeah, they don't.